Discussion on human rights is often very critical, sometimes even pessimistic. And I will speak about climate change and human rights. And of course, climate change is a very dangerous violation of human rights. And I try to be not pessimistic. I try to refer to best practice, since this is so dangerous that we should not be pessimistic. It is not allowed to be pessimistic. We must know what is working, which methods are successful, and on this basis we should proceed. climate change, of course, can cause multiple violations of human rights, and climate policy, therefore, is an important contribution to prevent such violations. It also depends on the strength of human rights in the country, whether you are successful with your climate policy. My special field is climate policy. Therefore, I would like to discuss with you the present state, but also the opportunities of this policy. Human rights provide strong moral arguments for climate protection. This is extremely important. However, they are comparable weak if you compare this with economic interests, for instance. Therefore, I want to focus on the issue, the question of how economic interests can be mobilized for climate policy. Human rights are fundamental rights to which a person is entitled in its dignity as human being. Freedom, justice, and peace are core values in the UN Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And climate change can violate the freedom to live in a certain place. It can even violate the right to exist, as you know. It can violate basic principles of justice, because a richer part of the world has caused existential dangers for the poorer part. And in the long run, it can cause violent conflicts about scarce resources, such as water, soil, and so on. The head of the climate system and of the UN, Cristiana Figueres, has made a very important statement recently, saying that changing weather patterns due to rising concentrations of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere are already affecting certain geographic areas. Some are becoming deserts, others being lost to the sea. The International Organization on Migration tells us this will affect global migration patterns as people attempt to escape the worst impacts of rapidly changing weather conditions. In fact, unless environmental disasters are averted by global action, the number of people in extreme poverty could increase by up to 3 billion in 2050, with all the ensuing social and economic conflicts. My research is actually on the question, can climate policy be accelerated? Can technical change in the world in the direction of climate-friendly technology be accelerated? Because we have the acceleration of climate change, as you know. This is a very dangerous development, and therefore this is a challenge for policy. It's a challenge for many policies, but also, of course, for climate policy and for industrial policy that tries to change the structure of technologies. I would like to, since I said I will be not pessimistic, I'd try to inform you about four mechanisms that accelerate, indeed, and have already accelerated technical change and have improved the situation of climate policy in the concrete case that I will speak about. There is a mechanism of international diffusion of technology-based climate policy innovations, a very important mechanism, the so-called less drawing. Countries learn from other countries how they have been successful, and then you have a diffusion of a certain type of policies. The second mechanism it is a bit complicated, but I will explain this. Interactive cycles of innovation. Innovation process can, in different parts of society, can interact and can reinforce themselves. No? That is the second mechanism of acceleration. And the third is the so-called lead market mechanisms. There are pioneer countries that organize markets for photovoltaic, for heat pumps, what else, passive houses. And afterwards, the technology diffuses into the world from this market. No? It's this market then, this lead market then is a kind of runway to start into the world. No? Again, a mechanism of acceleration. And the fourth mechanism is multi-level governance. Maybe the most interesting, and it is especially interesting in Germany, in Europe. The first mechanism, the mechanism of lesson drawing. this is a number of countries that have introduced feed-in tariffs to support renewable energy. More than 60 countries already have this, and you see this is a very rapid diffusion process. And to take another example, countries with a target for renewable energy are already nearly 120 countries in the world having such a target, saying we want to have 20% or 50% renewables to a certain time. And what is highly remarkable is that within 5 years, this number has doubled. And both examples are examples to show you how extremely rapid this change already is. Huh? Also the change of policies. Huh? But it is not the change of policies in terms of international negotiations, international agreements, and so on. There we have no success, and this is very difficult issue, and this follows a different approach. And this is the other approach, the approach where you make international agreements and try to be have rules for all countries of the world, hopefully legally binding, and so on. And you know, this is very difficult in climate policy. But this mechanism is new, and another mechanism, this mechanism of diffusion. No? Diffusion from pioneer countries with the same effect. No? Countries do something to support climate policy, to support the change of in the direction of climate-friendly technologies. You have the same effect, but a quite different mode. And the most interesting thing is that this is completely voluntary. You must not adopt feed-in tariffs in your country, but you adopt it because you see there's a country that has already some positive experience with this. And in climate policy, we have both the competition, so to speak, between both mechanism of global governance. my second mechanism of acceleration of technical change in the direction of low-carbon technologies, the second mechanism is the interaction of innovation cycles. And here you have the German case where an ambitious policy in 2000 led to an unexpected growth of climate-friendly technologies. In the last year, we had 25% electricity. And on the right hand, you see the targets. The first target was written into the law in 2000. The target was 20%. And at that time, in 2000, everybody said it's very ambitious, maybe not realistic, and so on. But 9 years later, when there was a booming development, the target was increased. No? There was a push then, please increase this target. The renewable energy sector said, no? we sell more photovoltaic installations if you have a more ambitious target. And the target was increased from 20 to 30. 1 year later, 35. And now there is a proposal of the minister, environment minister, to have 40% electricity from renewables. This is an interaction of three cycles. The policy induces market growth, and the market growth leads to innovation. Innovation that reduces costs, improves capacity, and so effectivity of the technology, and so on. And this again leads to a policy feedback. So this kind of feedback mechanism is very important, and I have studied many, many cases. It's not only Germany, but the most interesting case is China, where again the target was to have 20,000 megawatt wind capacity in 2020. That was 10 years ago. And then you see the real development on the left hand. Already in the last year, it was four times more than this old target from 10 years ago. And again, we have a policy feedback. The target was increased from 20 to 30,000 to 100,000 to 150,000. Now it is 200,000 megawatt wind energy in China. Within 10 years, the target was increased from 20 to 200. No? By the way, Germany has about 100 capacity, no? A bit more than 100. It is really remarkable, this target. Photovoltaic is similar in China. To take my third example from this acceleration mechanism, so far the examples are from renewable energy. This is a more easy policy. Not so easy is energy efficiency, no? to reduce consumption of energy and so on, and reduce the greenhouse gas emissions. But again, here we have the case of Britain. Again, we have a case where greenhouse gas reduction again had this kind of interacting dynamics. Britain had in 2008 a target to reduce greenhouse gases by 26% compared to 1990 in 2020. And only 1 year later, it was 34%, and now it is 50% in 2025. And again, this is a reaction of the policy, because the speed of reduction was unexpected. And this behind this development is there's a rapid a booming development for energy efficient technologies in the industry, in the building sector, and so on. There, things have been improved, and their market have been developed, even export markets. This would be the theoretical explanation, three cycles. But I come shortly to my third mechanism, lead markets. Lead markets are known in other fields, not only in climate policy. If you take internet started in the United States, and fax started in Japan, and mobile phones started in Finland or Scandinavia. That means the markets of the countries have paid the price to repay the costs of the development, no? of this technology, and to the customers in such countries pay the price for the improvement of this technology, for the price for innovations that reduce costs. Up to the point where this technology is good and cheap enough to diffuse into the global markets. No? There you need a strong start point, a strong market where this can start. And again, we have many in climate policy, we have many such markets, wind energy in Denmark and Germany, photovoltaic energy in Japan and also Germany, energy efficient fridges in Denmark, and so on. fuel-efficient cars in Germany. You see, this is a lead market development. You can describe it as such in this way. My fourth mechanism of acceleration has to do with the multi-level structure of global policy. And I take the European example. You may know that Europe has had some success with reducing greenhouse gas emissions. In the last year, the reduction was nearly 19%. The Kyoto target was 8. No? It was far above this. No? And you see, in the last year, there may have been some acceleration, although there has also a critical economic situation that also reduces, of course, emissions. But there has been some acceleration of this process. And if you try to explain this, you could refer to the main countries, the countries that have been most successful in this direction. That is, again, UK, Germany, and Denmark. And if you have a closer look to this on this kind of the three countries, you can observe a very interesting development. In all countries, very early you had experimental activities and innovations on the level of cities, for instance, below the nation state. And then the national policy started on this basis with such experiences in Copenhagen or Aarhus or Manchester or Munich or Freiburg. With such experiences, the policy started on the national level. And just after the start, the European level was entered by the same countries. And they influenced the European climate policy very strongly. And entering the European level meant for the three countries that they stabilized their own policy within the country. They could come from Brussels saying, now we must do this. But they themselves had formulated this policy. That's a typical mechanism. And what is most interesting is that this process started from below to Brussels and maybe to the global level and came back. And now this top-down development is extremely important because in countries as Germany or Denmark, you see that now on the local level, there's an extremely high dynamic of development. In Europe, there's so for the moment, we have many problems. But on the local level, you have a very rapid diffusion of climate-friendly technology, of green electricity. And this is a map of Germany, of the so-called 100% renewable energy regions. Already one quarter of the country with 20 million people that are part of this process. And this is so important because here, normal people are part of this process. Half of the installations for renewable energy in Germany come from private owners. The capital comes from private owner, from cooperatives and such. And the same in Denmark. In other words, we had a process bottom up and then top down. And when it came again top down to the same city, then there has been a new dynamic. And that can again be explained in terms of theory, but let me only mention one aspect of this. A pioneer city may influence the national policy with this special experience special innovations that has been introduced there. And if this policy goes to the higher level and comes back as a supporting mechanism, then you have a vertical support and a horizontal dynamic. That means that now other cities look to Freiburg and Munich and so on, because now there's a support mechanism from Europe Now other cities that have been pioneers are more interesting than before. And they learn from the pioneer cities now, the other cities entering this kind of policy. For instance, if you take the support for building codes and so on, this is a European policy. In 2020, every new building is due to be climate neutral, no? Nearly no energy consumption. If you want to implement this, you need the local level, no? The cities, no? They are responsible for this. And on this level, it depends on innovation and activity or not, no? Okay. That was the fourth mechanism, hopefully creating some hope for you in this field of climate policy. And the conclusion is that actually in climate policy, we must walk on two legs. The one is, of course, legally binding international agreements, the difficult part of the policy. And the other is the new part, which I tried to show, that is the mechanism of innovation diffusion. And the influence it has on the global technology development. We have this contradiction between the slow progress in international climate negotiation and the high dynamics of international competition on the global markets of clean energies. And therefore, what could be learned is that it's not only ideas and norms like human rights, which is extremely important. You must also mobilize economic interests. Huh? And this story I have told you tells you that you need both, no? The normative aspects and be effective with by mobilizing economic interests, by translating climate policy objectives into the language of markets, of innovation processes, and so on. And of course, this will be a historic contribution to protect human rights, of course. Thank you.